Hello, this is Richard Cespedes, and I'm here with a paper that I wrote long ago and forgotten, but dug up to revise again, called The Theory of Quantum Mechanics and Light. I would like to remind you that I'll be speaking of occipital atoms. What I mean are called occipital subatoms, made up of smaller matter. Okay, here we go. There are many forms of theories for light, and its quantum mechanic interactions with time and space. In this short review of my theories of light, I explain how I feel it works with time and space. Light exists in its own dimension that is touching every aspect of space and time. It exists in the present, past, and future. If you were to see through the eyes of light, it would show a dimension where there is nothing and everything. Light exists in the moment of what seems to be a sleepy existence of white, pure energy. Light is a knife that opens a womb in space-time, letting us see into its secrets. This energy of continuousness lets it bypass space and time, entering it and beyond, almost as if it's an alternate form of reality beyond our mythology. This theory of light exists in all major theories of space-time, theory of relativity, string theory, and quantum gravity. Light is so fast that it exists in its own warp time, separate from our dimension in this universe. It is so fast that it sits still, slightly warping space and time, from one quadrillionth of a second. When a form of man-made natural energy is created, like plasma, the main radiant source excites the very quantum atoms of space and time, transforming them into what is called the phototransformation, that in turn makes an occipital atom. This is a new name replacing photon, because this is two forms of matter that are not separate when one is released in the same space where the other is occupied. From the start, they have always combined to create a visual helping hand for the human brain. Let me explain how this is done. There are no photons that come off a main radiant source. It's the main radiant source that stimulates the atoms' continuous chain, causing them to transform into occipital atoms. No matter where a source of energy is created, it always intercepts this multidimensional atom chain of continuum. Everything in our universe intercepts this continuum. This is also what helps to make up the very fabric of space and time. So the atoms that are caught within the range of the radiant source in some ways are passing down a message in a form of energy to transform into occipital atoms that then become visual and give light in free space that enters our eyes, gets processed in our brains, into our occipital lobes, letting us see our universe. This phototransformation is what also causes the slight warping of space and time. This is called gravity flux dispersions. When the very act of a phototransformation occurs, it gives off a small rapid wave of energy that creates a gravity indention in space. This continues even after the birth of an occipital atom. The gravity flux dispersions affect space and time so much that it acts as a slight time disruptor that leaps over far distances, propelling itself almost as if teleporting, at the same time interweaving between space and time. This is what gives light the illusion of speed when in reality it's leaping over distances. An additional small amount of light from the occipital atom, 1/1,000,000,000th of a diameter of a normal atom, is reflected outward by gravity dispersions. The light is reflected because gravity dispersions is bending space-time, pushing everything outward, including its own radiant light. This atomic interaction with gravity and light is what also allows the occipital atoms to travel high speeds in free space. This mixture of gravity and light is called radiant gravity. This gives the occipital atom a form of lubrication to bypass space-time. This is the very nature that allows light to exist in between space and time. Let me explain. An acceptal atom carries a slight time warp, like a photo of a moment trapped in a capsule separate from time around it. This happens when it is created. This moment is measured not in minutes, but in energy, the atomic timeline. An atomic timeline is when energy is used to measure the distances of time shifts in our universe, like the shifts caused by photo transformation, that reach out in space by the use of gravity flux dispersions from light. The atomic timeline is not just an acceptable atom, but as soon as it traps this time shift, the time around it remains the same, which means that there are three different atomic timelines, one for the acceptable atom, one for the free space that light did not touch, and one for the radiant gravity that bypasses space and time. Basically, it's these differences that create the alternate time lapses that exist in the present, past, and future. The past because of the old energy that the acceptable atom traps when it is born. The future because of the radiant gravity that acceptable atom gives off that bypasses space-time. And the present because of the free space that light did not touch. Three different atomic timelines that are measured in three separate energies that determine the measurements of past, present, and future. These energies ultimately occupy the same space, creating the very light that lets the human brain see. Now to end this, I would like to describe the anatomy of the multidimensional atom chain of continuum and the acceptable atom. The multidimensional atom chain of continuum is made up of negatively and positively charged particles. The particles are made up of quarks, which then are made up of small subquarks that then make up the quark to make up the particle. The particles become acceptable atoms when the main radiant source intercepts this continuum. When this happens, the radiant source strengthens the magnetism of the positively charged particles by stimulating the quarks to create kinetic energy. This is called quantum kinetic condensation. This is done when the main radiant source heats the outer layer of the subquark. As it does this, the energy from the inside of the subquark, as I said about the atomic timeline, reacts to excite the quarks. This is because of the energy difference from inside the particle to the space around it. The inner energy of the particle is like a temperature that you can mess with, like window condensation. The subparticle walls heat up and the energy membrane at the center of the subparticle creates an energy film along its walls, 90% equal to the energy outside of it. Only 10% is the heat energy. Remember, time is an energy. The sub walls heat up with this energy. The energy inside reacts to this, like real condensation. It builds a film on it, capturing the time energy from the outside. This is what causes gravity flux dispersions. When the energy membrane reacts to the energy time entrapment forced by the main radiant source, the time energy is piercing in the subquark along with the heat energy. This causes the subquark to explode. This is due to the eternal energy leaking out like a balloon. We all know that positively charged and negatively charged particles always collide and destroy each other in free space anyways. But before any of this happens, at the beginning of the birth of the acceptable atom, the membrane gives off a major leakage, the first leakage, half a second, too fast to be seen. This energy burst is what's called the gravity flux dispersion. When this happens, it destroys the particles at the most quantum universal level. This is what causes the effect of the future. It erases the multidimensional chain of continuum to what time seems to be nothing, what gives the arrival of energy around it to free space to recreate, regenerate, and rewire itself, fresh and new. Now, to describe the positively charged particles, when they go through this complex phase, they become charged and become attracted toward their nearest neighbor, the negatively charged particles. When this happens, this creates what the fire gives off as glow, the shine that goes in far distances that light gives off. Because of the attraction of faraway negatively charged particles, the positively charged particles become attracted to, reaching out towards space.